线网线上上课的效果其实都比较稍微差一点，所以就在实体教育上课还是比较好。那我其实我明天也还有别的课，所以我对明天的那个课学生我也同样记了那个一样的通知题，跟他们说可能线上或者是实体教育上课配合那个活动的情况。
So we are opening in chapter 3, which consists of two parts. Last week we have already assigned the first part, crystal binding, to self-reading. So today I'm going to start.Right with part two, given here, it's about elastic constants, but more appropriately, it's actually about elastic mechanics in crystals. 实际上你看起来好像刚才谈的是一些弹性常数，类似弹簧常数，其实比较一个适合的一个名称，这个二组的名称应该是 elastic mechanics。我们其实谈的是晶体的那个弹性力学。Okay. So I will start with a brief introduction as to why this topic is important.In solid state physics, and also important for modern applications. Okay, 我们同学可能我们基本上都是想的是电子元件嘛 ，right？ 但是这个弹性力学的跟电子元件好像关联也不是很大，但是when we go to introduction, you will hear the reason.And how the elastic mechanics is relevant even in the modern electronic technology. Okay, 现在的电子这些科技上面其实有用到的。So and then I will start by a brief review of.This old friend, right, studied maybe at high school as well as in freshman physics, 高中啊，大一的普物有谈过的质量啊。So there are basically a particle with mass m, and there is also.A spring with spring constant k in this system. So it's well known that such a system many faced a restoring force described by Hooke's law. 它里面有个弹性恢复定。胡克定律所描述的 ，we will describe, we will review this, Hooke's law, and then, we'll first describe this, law in the, traditional way, where, this law is characterized.By the spring constant, 这里面有个 spring constant, right? And this spring constant determines the restoring force. So we'll first provide this traditional statement. then we are introduce new terms called string and stiffness constant, basically to replace the traditional quantities, the spring constant K, as well as the change in length of the spring delta L. So these two quantities that appear in the low will be replaced by new quantities, strain for this change in length, and stiffness, elastic stiffness constant for the spring constant K. 所以我们会把这个 K 和 delta L 呢，会把这个换掉。And basically, the two new quantities are the type of intrinsic quantities. 它们是叫做内在的量 as opposed to these two quantities, which are extrinsic ones. Okay.And we will also remind you what these extrinsic and the intrinsic quantities mean in science and the physics. 在这些内在或快要和外在的量是什么意思？其实这个在大家在物理或者一些 science 都听过，其实已经接触过了，所以就跟你比较明白的讲出来。And so throughout this chapter, we'll stay with such intrinsic quantities for the discussion of elastic mechanics. Basically, physics can be described in terms of either extrinsic quantities, such as the traditional Hooke law.You can state this law in terms of extrinsic quantities. But physics can also be equivalently described in terms of intrinsic quantities. So in this case, we'll show you how this intrinsic description can be made in terms of these new quantities.所以我会跟你讲有同样的一个定律，其实都是坦普克定律来，但是我可以用这些外在的量来写，我们传统上面的定律，但是也可以用这些新的内在的量来写，然后我也会再给你们一个例子。I will also give you an example which you actually already know in the.Theory of electrical circuits. 这研究所我相信大家都知道一点电路，电路里面有个 there is Ohm's law, Ohm 定律。And I believe most of you now have seen Ohm's law in both extrinsic and intrinsic descriptions. 它内在外在的那种描述其实都看过，所以我听它都提一下，会看到这个其实是你们已经知道的东西。好，然后in the last part of the review, I will discuss time-dependent elastic phenomena. Time-dependent.Which means elastic dynamics, 就是它会随时间改变的 because all applications, right, including our life, all depend on time evolving phenomena. 我们通常都是跟会我们作为生物，我们都是想要知道我下一刻该去干嘛，我去哪边找食物， 去哪边喝水，哎，对，你要预警，你的你可以要做预测的动作啊，所以你有心就知道哦，这个我现在关心的这个贪心线，我能不能预测它在时间上的一个演化，对吧？所以 basically 呢，哈 ，time dependence 啊 has to be 啊 studied 啊 in every application， right？ So here 呢，啊 ，we will remind you that the vibration in this mass spring system can be studied by combining this hook law. So this is our one of the laws that's needed. And also the second law of Newton.牛顿的第二命令，你当然要谈这些力学的时候，所以 you combine these two laws into differential equation, and then you can solve that equation to understand the vibration, which is time dependent.Mass spring system， 所以可以看到哦，这个其实，所以严格讲呢，其实 ，so rigorously speaking 呢，好 ，we have learned essentials of elastic mechanics， both this aspect of restoring force and the dynamics。So what's really what's going to be discussed in this lecture is how to generalize these description in the simple system to extended crystals, right, in 2D or 3D. 我们其实所有的应用是展延的系统，不是像这边哦。Here 呢 ，we have only a particle.A point, right? But actually, in applications, we are usually faced with extended structures, 延伸的系统 right? 有一个面积或者有一个体积的大小 extended structures. So this lecture is actually aboutthe generalization of elastic mechanics in that simple system to extended structures of crystals. Okay, so we will learn how to describe the relation between the restoring force and the change or elastic deformation, 弹性的变形，哎，变形如何产生那个力？这中间这个一个数学关系，那个叫做罗素，哦，要学哦，这个在展延系统的话要怎么描述？那so this is again described in terms of intrinsic.Quantities, strength. 然后 in fact, and also stress. Stress is a quantity, also an intrinsic quantity, which corresponds to the force here. 所以这边有两个量来 there is a restoring force.There is an elastic deformation. An elastic system. So basically, this elastic deformation will be described in terms of this strain, 我们就把它称作哦，这个叫应变啊。这个再顺便给大家讲一下，这个中文名字叫应变，中文名字叫应变。然后呢，the role of restoring force will be replaced by this stress known as 应力，在中文叫应力还是力，那中文还是用力，让你知道哎，它跟那个维度力是对应的啊。So then our Hooke's law呢will be given by a mathematical expression that relates the strain to the stress， 所以它主要是谈被应变跟应力之间的一个线性关系。那and somewhere in this section， we will consider。It's two types of strain, and the average and the local strain. In analogy to the quantities, average velocity and instantaneous velocity in mechanics. 在力学里面也有类似的概念。哦，我可以谈一个平均速度 ，right？你从家里从新竹开车到台中，你的平均速度，你有时候要慢一点或快一点，红绿灯会停下，所以你的平均速度或者是 average velocity， when you drive right from 新竹 to 台中 ，and we also talk about。Instantaneous velocity, right? The velocity at this moment. 你也会看哦，那我现在开在高速公路上，如果 if my instantaneous velocity exceeds the speed limit, then we may be fined, right? 会被开罚单啊，如果你的瞬时速度。所以你不能跟警察说哦，我的平均速度其实在你的时速。那个速限向来 ，even if your average velocity 呢，is below the speed limit， instantaneous velocity goes above the limit， you'll be written a ticket。好，所以 ，so and as mentioned already this spring constant。Which is also the quantity, right? Involved in the Hooke law will be replaced by an elastic stiffness quantity. So, and in all these discussions.You will see that as opposed to the 1D case here in 2D and 3D now, you will see the presence of more than one quantities for the strain. 它会有多于一个的分量啊。It's very much like a vector, 就像向量一般的 generally a vector, right, in 2D has two independent components. So this strain will be shown to be also some quantity that involves more than one independent component and such quantities.Called tensor 在数学上面他们有一个最大的一个范畴的这种讲法就叫做张量 with vector with scalar first of all scalar 就是存量 there is only one component in a scalar. For example, probability, right, is a scalar. Energy is a scalar, 量是一个单一的存量，然后几率也是一个单一的存量，好 ，scalar， and the vectors are also examples of tensor。所以 tensor 就所有的量都是 tensor， 但是 tensor 就是有单一的量的存量，我们叫做存量，有两三个量的向量，哎，它还有更多的量呢，叫矩阵 ，matrices are also examples of tensor quantities。So here now you will see that strain, stress, and the elastic stiffness constants in 2D and 3D now each involve more than one component, and therefore they are tensors as opposed to.Spring constant K, right, which is only one component, restoring force, elastic deformation as well, are only one component quantities. 但意味说，哦，你不知道这个都不用用到什么向量矩阵的观念，一个量，其实不是。一般的描述，甚至牵涉到多重的量，多重的。叫做 tensor 的量 ，OK， and so later 呢 ，you will see that this C 呢 is actually a matrix. In particular 呢，in my lecture, it will be a 3x3 matrix involving 9 components， 它有九个量哦。But because of certain symmetry in physics, including crystal symmetry, right? If you have a crystal with non-trivial symmetry, rotation, inversion, or reflection, right? As we mentioned earlier, then it turns out this C.这边我把它叫做 C double teardown to indicate the matrix nature. Also, I will use this notation double teardown to indicate its matrix type quantity. Actually, this matrix will show corresponding symmetry when there is.Certain crystal symmetry in our elastic system. 当你的弹性系统，你用的晶体里面有某些对称性，所以你的这个 C double teardown 也会里面也会显示对应的对称性。所以这就是说明为什么我们固态物理尤其我们在第一章来我们要谈一些crystal 对称性，它真的会出现在你的应用里面的一些相对。像 Spring 没问题，你去知道说 OK， 我要知道 K， 我才能知道怎么把这个方法拿去做些什么应用。那这个也是一样，你要知道 C tier 的 double tier 的，它也跟 symmetry 有关。So then 呢，background then we will eventually.Be able to describe 2D or 3D Hooke slope. And then, in the last part of this lecture, this chapter, we will discuss dynamics in 2D, 3D elastic structures. Okay, so now we will talk about时间上面的这些演化才表示，你这个问题你了解的够深，然后you are ready for applications， 你就可以去做应用。好，所以这是我们这一章最终会学到的东西。好，那 OK， so let me begin with a brief introduction. In fact, justification, right, for the topic. So basically, you know, let me name two important applications in association with elastic mechanics. The first one being devices known as MEMS. MEMS is a shortened name for micro electro mechanical system. M for micro, E for electro, then M again for mechanical, and S here for system. 所以这个在中文里面呢, this is boundary, this is known as 微积电. 所以这个大家就知道我们学校就有微积电 这个研究所, right, 在东极系, 所以就知道, 这确实是一个领域, 它都已经变成一个研究所. So basically, such devices are very small. They are microsystems. And they are able to convert between electrical signal. 所以这边有electrical, so these, imagine these are electrical signals sent to your devices. Electrical signal. And these electrical signals can be converted to mechanical signals, which may be vibrations. So when someone call you, right, your cell phone starts to vibrate when it receives the signal. 就是这个它里面有类似的, right, 这样的系统, 收到电的讯号来了, 它可能震动提醒, but such systems can also operate in the reverse way. Some of the systems can take mechanical vibrations and convert it to electrical output. 有时候我们去那个, if you go to science museum, right, 那个为了要, in order to educate 那个 children, 他们有时候会有一些, 发电机, 你脚去踩, 会发电, 这就是简单的, 把机械能量转成电的能量, so basically, but the important thing is that while large electromechanical systems are well known, right? However, these are micro, right? 做的小小的不简单。So this is this is the first applications because here it involves vibrations, which is obviously determined by the corresponding Hook law, right, of the crystal. 所以这里面那个元件的那个固定律里面的一些常数是什么？这个弹性常数，你需要知道， right? 然后呢, second example 呢, is given by strand layer layer AP, 我们就简单讲 AP structures. These are semiconductor structures consisting of maybe two or more different semiconductor materials. So for example, you could have silicon on this side and germanium on this side, grown into a single crystal-like structure. 好，不要看哦，我这里 there is a silicon crystal which we have already described in chapter one, and there is also germanium crystals. Right? But in order to grow these two materials into a single crystal, this means you have to take care, for example, let me denote germanium atoms by these two circles, with this separation being the germanium lattice constant, while silicon atoms here now may have a slightly smaller lattice constant, because these are two different materials. So generally, the interatomic spacing can be different. So in order to grow one material on the other in a single crystal way, you have to try to align silicon atoms with germanium atoms. Perhaps by compress these two germanium atoms slightly and stretch these two silicon atoms slightly to match these two materials so they can grow atom on atom, right, with high crystallinity. 你为了得到高的晶性哦，它整个要长得像一个 crystal， 所以它虽然你这个是 silicon， 这个是 germanium， 本来它们天然的晶格长度不太一样哦，你长上去以后它们会自哦。So this interatomic spacing 呢 during the growth will be automatically adjusted by the underlying elastic properties, elastic physics. 他们会由于弹性，那个 if you compress the germanium atom and stretch the silicon atoms, there will be elastic energy involved. 这是要付出代价的。你把它天然的那个晶格长度把它有一个要压缩下，有一个要拉开一下，这就像弹簧，所以是有能量要 付出去的。所以 therefore 呢 the final lattice constant in this structure is actually determined by the elastic physics of these two materials.So this is again an important application in modern semiconductor applications, because this means you can grow new semiconductor materials which are not existent in the nature. 自然界不会有这个东西。So these are lab made, and they can provide new properties which are neither those of silicon nor those of germanium. Generally, it has new properties, and therefore you can explore potential new applications. 所以这是很重要的东西。来，看自然界就只给你 silicon germanium， 在张总讲的那个 26， including 2635 semiconductors， there are actually a variety， right？ Already a variety of semiconductor materials in the nature. But however, now for important applications, sometimes you wish to create artificial semiconductors, man-made semiconductors, 就是人工自己做出来的新的，它就有新的心理学家，新的心理学家，那个自然界的材料都更适合我们要做的某些应用。所以这是modern for modern electronic applications。那这些材料这种so basically you can grow such materials by a few technologies known as LPE， 我就不讲它全名来 LPE 然后 CVD and BE and all these facilities actually exist on our campus。我们不同系都有哦，大家不要以为这个材料系我们电机系都有，所以这些都是真正大家在做的事情哦。然后你看这个弹性力学需要 ，right？ You do not want your new structure 呢 to deform germanium or silicon 呢？Too much, because if you deform this material too much, defects will start to appear. 你知道，所有的东西你要，你要硬拉、硬拉、硬拉，到最后它就东西要断裂，开始有缺陷，然后 eventually 呢，they do not have good quality, good crystallinity, good crystal.Quality for making devices， 所以后来 device 啊，这个就太糟了，不能做。There will be lots of defects near this interface， 这个界面上 ，you will even block the current。所以 this is why you need to grow this carefully with。These techniques. With this last one, MV being an expensive technology. Section of review of the MK system. Let me call it MK. So basically, here now we imagine we have a fixed end here, and this is a spring attached to the fixed end.Then here we have a mass capital N attached to the spring. So traditionally, we for the description, we refer to a few quantities.For example, L0 here as the natural length, which is the length of the spring without any deformation, without any tension. 它里面没有任何紧张度在里面，有那个放松的状态，就是 natural length. And L 呢 as
lens of the moment, so let me call it present lens. There's a hello here. That's the change in lens. So this could be a stretch, right? If we have a positive delta L or compression. If delta L is negative, stretch your compression, stretch the zone, and then sometimes it's also known as dilation. Dilation 一般是一个体积，这个没关系，我们就叫混用。所以呢，and there is the spin constant, and there is the mass. So Hooke's law here.Gives us the restoring force F. So F here now is the restoring force. Equal to minus K delta L, right? With this important minus sign.on the right-hand side, 它是回复 ，right， 回复力。好，那 ，OK， 然后 let me， before I going into intrinsic quantities， let me remind you that， you can equivalently describe this.Hooke law in terms of the elastic potential energy V of L. So let me call this the elastic energy stored in the system versus the lens. Then typically this.Potential energy looks like this. So usually, if you focus on a small region near the minimum, then the curve here can beExpanded. So for V of L near L0, right, with the minimum occurs right at L0. And this V of L near L0 is given by this Taylor expansion V of L0, the Taylor 在数学式 right, plus the.First order term, but the slope right at the max minimum is zero, right? So therefore, the first order term does not enter, so we go to the second order term. V double prime.Meaning the second order derivative at L0 times the difference delta L squared. And then you can go on to the cubic and higher order terms, which are generally known as n-harmonic terms.Mention this term and harmonic terms, meaning cubic and higher order ones. Okay,
所以你可以有三阶四阶的统拔加起来，因为泰勒展示很多。那 usually 呢lots of applications we are only interested in the neighborhood of this minima, meaning that this LO is only slightly different from LO0. So for LO near LO0, if you drop these enharmonic turns, then we end up with an ideal parabola. And if you consider the corresponding force F following the freshman physics, the corresponding force is given by the negative gradient minus dE/dL, and we end up with minus V double prime times delta L, right? So therefore now, this result here says that the spring constant K na is actually the second order derivative of V at the minimum of L0.这其实就是它的二次微分，那个弹力方式就是二次微分。So this serves as a reminder that generally Hooke's law is only valid in the vicinity of the equilibrium， 它就在这个平衡点附近才是有效的。When you move away from the equilibrium, you eventually have to consider effects of these enharmonic turns, which also have important implications in solid state physics. 后面这一项也有重要性。So in chapter 5, this 第五章, when we go to chapter 5,will describe some effects in association with these enharmonic terms in crystals. 它在 crystal 是会有效应，而且它甚至对于电子元件也有一些重要性，你要知道的。所以不要想说哦，这里面现在都看不到电子 ，right? Even though now we do not see explicit electrons in this chapter, but these discussion are actually relevant to device applications. 跟元件、电子元件的应用是有关系的。好，所以这边就提醒大家哦，不要想我胡克定律谈的是一个完美的，没有哦，我们就是。谈的都是实际应用上，你胡克定律要小心，我在这个震荡不很大的时候，我可以震荡比较大的时候就有一些高阶项的 cubic 还有 order terms 好，这就是提醒一下。好，那 next， so let me go to the intrinsic descriptionSo let me first introduce the new quantity denoted by epsilon and called strain as the ratio delta L over L0. So this describes the relative change in length
1%。所以你看，它没有这里面弹哦，你这个弹簧本身改变量是一个 centimeter。What the actual change in length?Actual delta L now may be, for example, 1 centimeter, right? But when you talk about this relative change in length, now you do not refer to the natural length. 你不需要知道它原来的。You do not also refer to the actual change in length. And from this ratio,1%, you can already have some feel about the degree of tension. 跟你说 1% 的一个长度变化，你就开始有点感觉哦，这个有一些张力在里面哦， right? You can get some feel about the tension.While this 1 centimeter may not suitably describe the tension, because you can consider two springs, right? With one spring having natural length at, for example, 2 centimeter. 假设哎，我有一个弹簧的天然长度只有2 centimeter, then this change delta L equal to 1 centimeter actually implies a very large tension. 把2 centimeter 再拉一个 centimeter, 可能它都要断掉了，所以这个有一个很大的。But if this delta L occurs in a very long spring, for example,1 meter long. 假如我是一个一米的长度，有一米长度的弹簧，你拉一个 centimeter， 可能根本没有什么恢复力，right? 所以说 this is why now, in some sense, this relative change in length may be more suitable, right? Quantity, maybe a more suitable quantity for the description.Elastic deformation. 虽然两个都是要去描述deformation, 两个 both delta L and this ratio epsilon aim to describe the same deformation, but the message contained in these two quantities are not equivalent.并不等价，一个人不等价。然后 ，at the same time 呢 ，let's be reminded that the spring constant K is actually inversely proportional to the natural length. 这个是高中的 ，this is from high school physics.是一般你们应该知道，来弹簧越长，哎，我同样的圈数的弹簧哦，if you fix the number of, for example, copper coils per unit length, 你知道这个，我那个每一个单位长度，那个弹簧圈，那个铜圈的圈数越多，我的弹簧就越弹力长度越大嘛，来。But you also remember now, if you fix this number of coils per unit length, and you try to increase the length, then the corresponding spring constant decreases with 0.0 or 两倍的弹簧。两倍长度弹簧的弹力长度就是原来的一半，因为大家记得，如果你 So if you have two identical springs with each having the same spring constant K, then if you apply an overall change in length delta L, this means each spring has to only share half of the change. And therefore, now, although you apply delta L, but the actual restoring force is given by half of that for a single spring. Right? 单独一条弹簧, for a single spring subject to the same change. 同一个, 所以我有刚才的弹簧两倍的话, 我要拉开一个centimeter, 它个别弹簧只要分摊 0.5个centimeter, 分摊比较小, 对回复力, 整个弹簧的回复力就等于一根的, 它受到的那个应变只有一半, 力就变小, K变小, 所以, so this is why this K decreases as you increase the length. So therefore, this also means if I form the product of K and L0, then this C, while it also describes the capability of elastic restoration, right? 它也是描述,哦,我多有能力恢复, but this then is independent. This is a quantity independent of the actual natural length. So this C, therefore, now for a long spring and for a short spring are identical, and this can be regarded as a material constant. 或者是刚才那个那一类的弹簧的某个参数, 就不会跟你实际弹簧, 所以想象一个弹簧的公司, so imagine there is a factory fabricated, dedicated to the fabrication of springs. So what it will give to the customers is this C, telling them what is mine. C here is known as the, and this is known as the elastic stiffness constant. Which is basically the spring constant for a spring of unit length. 当你刚好是一单位长度, 它的K就等于C. So this factory will only provide its customer the information about C. And then a customer can decide, whether I want a spring of 1 meter or 1 centimeter. The customer has to convert, right? Customer can convert this information of C into the spring constant K for his or her application. 在他实际的应用里面呢，他到底的K要多少，他自己去换算一下，然后最后去跟 工坊效应，然后那你帮我做一个 meter long 的，所以这个 customer 不需要，这个 customer 不是这个 factory 不需要 ，so the factory doesn't have to list its spring constant for every
increase even length， 它不需要哦，我一个 meter 是多少 ，half meter 是多少，那个一个 centimeter 又是多少，不需要练那么 一大堆东西，练一个 c 就好。So this intrinsic constant 呢 ，actually 啊 ，is in some sense 呢。Is very provides a very efficient description of the elastic property, right? Of the coils, 就是线圈，线圈上面的弹力系数是多少？当然，它会列的，就是说，它可能会列说，哦，我有。两类的线圈 ，right? It can sail maybe two types of copper coils, right? With one, for example, given by 我随便写 ，right? Given by four coils, four turns, right? Four turns per centimeter. 然后 there is another one, with only two turns.这个它倒是可以给这个，但是呢，至于你要用这个 four turns， 有些顾客他选择这个，然后他用这个做，最终他用这个做到两个 centimeter， 所以这个工厂他不会给每一个实际长度的时候我的弹力那个弹簧长度多少，他给的是这种，我转几圈的，我的这个 c 是多少，他跟你讲，这样就够了。So this.Basically, belongs to the intrinsic descriptions. It has nothing. This is independent of actual size of the spring. So, in physics, now you have already seen such.Quantity, such numbers, such as mass density, right? 比如说斯里肯，你也从来，你只要给一个 mass density， 你也不会跟人家讲哦，你要这个一个立方公分的那个斯里肯是多重，然后要。立方公尺又是多重，你不会去讲的，对不对？就是比方说，哦，这个 low 是多少 mass density， 它就可以适用在你到底是谈一立方公或一立方公尺，然后顾客自己在开那个订单的时候，自己在跟他讲，哦，我其实要的是0.5立方公尺的来说，好，所以说 mass density、charge density。Current density, right? These are the intrinsic quantities frequently encountered in physics. And so here, now let me mention this Ohm's law in physics.You can describe this Ohm's law in the traditional way. For example, E equals the product of I and R, with B here in the voltage bias applied, I being the current, and R here being the resistance.And all these quantities are actually size dependent. For example, now we know that this resistance R is proportional to the length of the resistor and inversely proportional to the area, cross section area of the resistor. 它跟那个 电阻的截面积乘算。所以你看 ，so it depends on this quantity R here 呢 ，depends on the actual size, the length, and the cross section area of the resistor. Now, similarly, this current here now is given by J current density times the cross section area. So it also depends on the size of the device. But this low now can be stated.All in terms of these extrinsic quantities. 所以这些就是外在的量 these extrinsic quantities are directly, they are directly linked to applications.
我们最终要放在你家里的你当然要知道它的尺寸大小啊，right? 你不会说哦，像那个厂商，它可以比较简化的描述，我只给你那个刚才这个 resistivity load， 哎，不够啊、哦！我要知道我家里那个我要预留下来的那个空间要放这个 resistor， 哎，所以呢，在实际最终应用的时候，我们会回到 extrinsic， 因为 because extrinsic quantities are the quantities that are directly linked to the actual world of applications. However, in scientific discussion, you can describe the same law maybe more efficiently in terms of intrinsic quantities.Where this E now replaces the bias with this E here being the electric field. So in terms of E now, this bias then is given by E times length, right? So again, this V now depends on the actual size. However, this electric fieldThis is the J mark, right? Current density, this is the resistivity. 最小心一下 let me label this by M to distinguish it from our resistivity. So this node here is the resistivity, 叫电阻率 this is given by.The inverse of conductivity. Here is the electrical conductivity, which will be discussed in chapter 6. So let me mention here. This equation here provides.An intrinsic description of the same physics law without any reference to the actual length or area of the resistor.
看我这里面一直描述同时，但我这里完全没有看到哦，你到底这个适用不适用在我这个要？resistor 也有各种，有比较小的，有比较粗的，这种就你如果去那个电子材料的那个店里面，就知道有各种 resistor， 有大的有小的。所以呢，你可以用全部用同一个定律来描述，只要它是同一个电阻材料。If these various resistors are all fabricated using the same semiconductor material, then they all have the same resistivity. So this equation allows you to
write down the home slope for variance for a variety of resistors. 那所以呢，这个就是大家已经知道的欧姆定律。这边，
可是我们通常这里有时候呢 ，sometimes， we like to write J on one side and invert like this low 呢 ，and move it to the other side. So this may be the more popular equation for the intrinsic.比较长，看到是那个了，所以是一对。那其实也就把楼移到另外一边去。好 ，so we have seen the intrinsic description in the theory of electric circuits。好，因为上面已经看过。So here 呢。Let me now go back to our Hooke's law and try to state the law in terms of this C and also epsilon. So then our F equal to minus K delta L.Can be replaced by introducing this quantity L0 explicitly in the expression and cancellation of this L0 by.This denominator, and then the product of k and L0 呢can be replaced by c, and the ratio delta L over L0 呢can be replaced by epsilon. So this now provides us a statement in terms of.Intrinsic quantities， 所以你看它用 intrinsic 可以写出来这个。那 at the same time 呢？Earlier we talked about the corresponding potential energy, right? So for the elastic potential energy, you can also have this.Potential energy as 1 half k delta L square, right? If we drop the constant energy term, 你把前面那个 V of L0 the energy at the minimum is dropped from the expression, then you end up with this.Parabolic expression for the elastic energy stored in the spring, all in terms of extrinsic quantities. 所以这个就谈，你那个整个弹簧哦，那么长的弹簧，这一刻到底储存多少能量？所以他谈的就是实际上面的。However, 呢 you can also.Convert this to an intrinsic expression without reference to any actual size. By dividing this potential energy by the natural length of L0, so this gives us.Energy density, right? Or energy per unit length， 就是有点，这就是能量密度喽。哦，每一单位的那个谈话里到底储存有多少能量的意思。哦，然后呢 ，then 呢 ，on the other side， we get k delta l square over this factor l zero once。And then you add another power to the denominator and balance that power. I also give in one power to k. Then this can again be rewritten in terms of c epsilon squared.所以你看 when you write the energy in terms of C and epsilon it gives you the energy per unit length 每单位长度，所以你可以看到这个慢慢有点感觉哦。intrinsic 一般如果我即使左边一开始没有写下来的时候你下面就要想哦，它没有，当我看到这个看起来我知道像 跟那个弹性位能有关，那虽然我没有看到左边是除 L 的，但是你会知道哦，这个跟任何长度都无关的，这个量跟能量应该基本上就是一个单位长度的位能。哎，那你可以也可以这样子写一写，有看出来。 So this expression 呢、will also 呢be generalized later when we go to 2D and 3D. 所以这边我就先让大家看到哦，能量会这么写，来，然后五个定律会怎么写，在这个熟悉的这个质量弹簧系统。Quantities that go into the workflow. So here now we only have one component for C and also for epsilon and also for the restoring force in the mass spring system.When we go to 2D and 3D, let me particularly choose or confine our discussion to 2D because I can draw the graph relatively easily for a 2D structure. So please refer to the textbook, read the textbook.For a discussion of 3D， 实际上我们的课本一直都谈三维的，但是我上课谈二维，所以让你二维、三维都学到。哎，你要 read the textbook。So basically, let me be focused on 2D. Okay, so first of all, in comparison to 1D, where we only have one type of strain, right, which is stretch. Or compression. 它只有在那个方向来 you can only stretch or compress the spring along the spring axis. This is the only type of strain which can be applied. However, here, let's consider maybe a rectangular elastic system with natural length Lx sub 0 for the x dimension of Ly sub 0 for the y dimension. 所以这个首先它有两个 there are two parameters of natural length, right? 那 also there are various types of strength which can be applied. For example, you can stretch this structure horizontally by delta Lx, right? Okay, so 一般让它拉长一点。So this gives us our first type of strain, 水平拉长了，这听起来跟那个弹簧很像，哎，水平拉长。那 similarly, you can also stretch this structure in the y direction by delta y, delta l y, right? Okay, a y 方向拉长一点，所以你看 ，so there are already two different types of strain in comparison to just one type, right? One D. Moreover, you can also generate a new type of strain called shear strain. Which transform this rectangle to a parallelogram by applying a pair of tangential forces. 你使用水平的牵力。So here now, this type of strain can be generated by applying a pair of tangential, 我们叫做这些 tangential forces, okay? Fire, for the first two types, you apply basically normal forces.正向力，正向力，施的力垂直于这个边，好 ，normal forces. So for a 2D structure, you can apply these two different types of forces to generate shear strain with tangential forces.And you can also apply the forces in the vertical direction, right, to deform the structure into this parallelogram and give a deformation down.So on the surface, it looks like there are
four types of deformation as opposed to only one type. 对，这边你看 ，so now we have four types。好，就是所以当所以物理本身没有什么真实质上的一个大的变化，就变化就是有点像是一种描述，哦，从单重的现在变多重了，哦，比较好像数学比较扩大。那 if you take a few minutes to think about these four types, then you may be convinced these are the only elementary types of deformation. Okay. A general deformation can be formed.Out of these four different types, 你可以用这四个 ，you can combine these four types into an arbitrary deformation. 所以这个四个呢就是基本的了。你如果想一想，你如果有想到不同的，你再告诉我。If you discover a new type.Deformation, let us know. This only elementary types. Okay. 好，那 how do we define the corresponding strain? So the first one, we follow our earlier discussion.In 1D, and introduce this quantity epsilon xx as the ratio of this change in length over the natural length. So this is a straightforward generalization.Earlier epsilon. Now this double subscripts here refers to the subscripts x in the numerator and the denominator. So xx type. Now similarly for the second type deformation.Introduce this notation epsilon. So yy as the ratio ly over ly0. For the third type, we actually describe this deformation by the tilting angle. Let me call this theta x.The tilting angle, 就是它倾斜的角度 tilting angle. For the parallelogram. So basically, denote this corresponding quantity by epsilon xy. So this epsilon xy now.It's theta x and it's basically given by delta l x. Because if you look at the upper edge, has been displaced, 它被移动了 by delta l x, okay?This is not stretch, as in the first type. This is a shift. 它虽然不是拉长，但是它是一种移动嘛，然后它也移动了 delta l x. So it's given by the ratio for this angle. It's given by
find the ratio of the displacement over the natural length, L y 0. For small, right here now, we will mainly be interested in small deviation from equilibrium, 就是所有我们谈出的小幅度的变形啊，所以 angle when this angle theta is small 呢, it's approximately given by the ratio by this ratio. 这些是三角函数的东西，就解我们具体的镜子。 So then there's two substrates, X and Y, refer to the labels or subscripts in the numerator and the denominator. So for the last one, similarly, we introduced the quantity X on YX. And let me call this angle theta y. So angle theta y given by delta L. Delta L y over the horizontal h. L x 0. So this gives us the full strength parameters and generally now you may be a few of these four for an arbitrary strength, right? 一个任意的 strength 可能是我有那个量有多少然后这个量有多少 So let me stop here for our quiz.